Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by BNSF Railway, Consumer Cellular.
Supporting social entrepreneurs and their solutions to the world's most pressing problems. SkollFoundation.org.
The Lemelson Foundation, committed to improving lives through invention in the U.S. and developing countries. On the web at lemelson.org. Supported by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, committed to building a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. More information at macfound.org. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Yet another wave of anti-government demonstrations paralyzed parts of Hong Kong on this Christmas Day. Black-clad protesters descended on the streets of a busy shopping district. Riot police used tear gas to disperse crowds. Meanwhile, hundreds marched through malls chanting pro-democracy slogans. The city has been upended by more than 6 months of unrest against police use of force and mainland China's influence. New protests erupted in India's capital today over a controversial new citizenship law. Students, writers, and activists gathered at a college campus in New Delhi to denounce the legislation. It grants expedited citizenship to migrants illegally in the country, excluding Muslims. Protesters accused the government of violating India's secular constitution.
India has been shaken. The idea of constitution has been shaken by this government. And when the soul of constitution has been targeted by any government, then it has changed in this regime.
Peaceful protests also continued in India's eastern state of Assam. We'll take a broader look at the recent wave of protests around the world later in the program. More than 200,000 Syrians have fled an onslaught of violence in Idlib province in recent weeks. That's according to the Syrian Response Coordination Group, a relief group active in the area. The exodus continued today as crammed trucks headed north towards the Turkish border. Civilians are being pushed out by Syrian President Bashar al-Assad's forces working to regain control of Syria's last rebel stronghold. There was temporary relief in Australia today as cooler weather slowed down the spread of devastating wildfires. But forecasters warned higher temperatures are expected to return this weekend. About 2,000 firefighters spent this Christmas holiday battling more than 70 fires still burning in New South Wales.
Fire doesn't stop just because it's Christmas, so some of the crews have to keep working and monitor the fire. Luckily today we've got benign weather and not everybody has to be out here.
In his annual Christmas address today, Australian Prime Minister Scott Morrison paid tribute to two firefighters who died last week battling fires southwest of Sydney. And this Christmas Day brought a number of celebrations, both solemn and festive, around the world. Christians in Bethlehem sang hymns of worship, while in Germany, brave swimmers dove into icy waters for their annual Christmas plunge. U.S. troops stationed in South Korea gathered to enjoy a Christmas feast. Meanwhile, President Trump and First Lady Melania Trump, who are celebrating the holiday in Florida, sent this message to all Americans serving abroad.
We say a special prayer for those military service members stationed far from home, and we renew our hope for peace among nations and joy to the world.
Pope Francis also hoped for peace during his annual Christmas Day message in St. Peter's Square. He spoke to the plight of migrants and refugees and said the light of Christ was stronger than human suffering. The Pope also issued a separate statement with the head of the Anglican Church and the former moderator of the Church of Scotland, urging South Sudan's rival leaders to form a coalition government early next year. Still to come on the NewsHour, the year in climate change, what it means for the Earth's future. Recounting the major global events of the decade and their impact on the world. Concerns about the ability to repair Paris's Notre-Dame Cathedral and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
By almost any measure, 2019 was a year of especially sobering news about climate change, not only because of new findings and grim warnings about what could happen, but because some extreme weather events happening now. It was also a year where a movement grew from the ground up to try and tackle the problem. But as Miles O'Brien explains, the call for action was often divorced from political reality. His report tonight is part of our regular coverage of the leading edge of science.
When Apollo astronauts looked back at the tiny blue marble in the vast inky void that we call home, they were awestruck by its beauty. That you might have predicted.
But there was a surprising aspect. Somehow the Earth projected a feeling of fragility.
Apollo 11 crew member Mike Collins.
If I had to describe just in one word what the Earth looked like from the moon, I would say fragile.
50 years later, the collision between that fragility and humanity's indifference to it came closer to home, much closer. When the final numbers come in, scientists predict 2019 will be the second or third hottest year on record. It means the past 6 years were the warmest six since humans started keeping track. In Australia, they are feeling the heat like never before. On December 18th, the country logged its hottest day on record, a national average high of 107.4 degrees Fahrenheit. Along with the heat came hundreds of wildfires, fueled by drought-parched brush. Wildfires once again ravaged California this year. A 250,000 acres burned. In September, the remnants of Tropical Storm Imelda dumped more than 43 inches of rain on Texas. The seventh wettest cyclone ever to hit the U.S. left $2 billion in damage behind. And also in September, Category 5 Hurricane Dorian slow-rolled the Bahamas.
The waters were extremely warm. It was warmer than normal. And so you have conditions for a perfectly exploding storm.
Meteorologist Wayne Neely watched the satellite images with equal parts disbelief and terror.
I knew that beneath that storm, beneath that image, there was going to be great devastation. I knew that houses were going to be toppled. I knew that buildings were going to be destroyed. Lives were going to be impacted. I knew that there was going to be death. It had a pit in my stomach for that.
Dorian's 20-foot storm surge killed 67 and obliterated 13,000 homes. The impact made greater by rising sea levels, which in November helped turn high tides in Venice into the worst flooding in more than 50 years. And the threat of even greater sea level rise looms as the West Antarctic ice sheet faces further assault. The water captured in the ice here would raise global sea levels by more than 10 feet. And scientists have concluded Thwaites Glacier, which accounts for 2 feet of that, is more precarious than they once thought. Early in the year, a NASA airborne radar found a 1,000-foot hole at the base of the glacier. New York University mathematician David Holland is there now, a lead investigator with the International Thwaites Glacier Collaboration.
We are trying to head to that location now to carry out a field campaign to investigate how warm ocean waters are currently causing it to change elevation and melt very rapidly.
Our oceans, which absorb so much of the heat humans are creating, are changing rapidly. Temperature-sensitive coral reefs continue their precipitous decline. We've lost more than one quarter of them in the last 30 years. And scientists who study one of the fastest warming bodies of seawater in the world, the Gulf of Maine, are making a grim forecast for the next 30 years.
If the planet continues to warm up at an accelerated rate because we haven't taken care of the carbon problem, that's when, you know, Maine starts to have temperatures that feel more like you'd think of New Jersey, and we don't really think of New Jersey as a lobster state.
As the planet steadily warms, the scientific picture grows steadily clearer. In May, global carbon dioxide levels surpassed 415 parts per million, an unprecedented high. In November, scientists gathered in Geneva to deliver a stark warning. Global greenhouse gas emissions are still on the rise. And for the world to limit temperature rise to 1.5 degrees Celsius, we must reduce annual emissions by 30 billion tons in the next decade. That is about half of what we emit now.
We would have had to reduce our emissions by 3%.
Inger Andersen is executive director of the United Nations Environment Program.
Now, because of climate procrastination, which we have essentially had during these 10 years, we are looking at a 7.6% reduction every year. Is that possible? Absolutely. Will it take political will? Yes. Will we need to have the private sector lean in? Yes. But the science tells us that we can do this.
But geopolitics tells us just the opposite.
The United States will withdraw.
In November, the Trump administration began withdrawal from the 2015 Paris Agreement, under which 187 nations pledged to cut greenhouse gas emissions enough to keep global temperatures from rising no more than 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. This set the stage for a failed United Nations summit on climate in Madrid. The U.S., Brazil, and Saudi Arabia successfully blocked an agreement on how to implement the Paris goal.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam President. Good morning to everyone.
Patricia Espinosa is Executive Secretary of the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change.
We are not acting quickly enough to enact the deep transformation throughout society that will save humanity's future on this planet. We are out of time.
Among those addressing the summit, 16-year-old Swedish climate change activist Greta Thunberg, who this year mobilized a global grassroots campaign to force politicians to recognize and respond to the realities of climate science. In September, she sailed on a solar-powered boat to the United Nations General Assembly in New York City. That's where she sat down with the NewsHour's William Brangham.
We should not underestimate ourselves, because if lots of individuals go together, then we can accomplish almost anything. So that's what I want people to take out from this.
But are enough people ready? Turning the tide will require some hard choices about how to power our future and pay the bill. But it does appear the public is at an inflection point. This year, Gallup reported two-thirds of Americans believe global warming is caused by pollution from human activities rather than natural changes in the environment. And yet, only 44% say they worry a great deal about it. But don't count an intrepid Apollo astronaut among them.
I feel about the planet today in a different way. Having gone out 240,000 miles and seeing it gives me a much greater sense of fragility, a much greater urge to protect that fragility as we go on.
In 2019, increasing numbers of Earthlings got the same urge, not because they saw trouble from afar, but rather because it came ever so close to home. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Miles O'Brien on Fragile Planet Earth.
In foreign policy, the past 10 years have seen both transformation and inertia. In many countries, the leaders have changed, but an authoritarian style of leadership hasn't. New powers are emerging, but are as opaque as ever. And evolving domestic politics could lead to new relationships between the United States and its allies. NewsHour's chief foreign affairs correspondent Nick Schifrin discusses this decade of discontent with three people who have shaped U.S. foreign policy.
As we close the 2010s, we look back at this year and this decade in foreign affairs and global security. We'll tackle a few main topics with an all-star cast. Michelle Flournoy, Deputy Secretary of Defense under President Obama and co-founder and managing partner of West Exec Advisors, a national security advisory firm. Rebecca Heinrichs, a former congressional security aide, now senior fellow at the Hudson Institute. And from London, Corey Shockey, a National Security Council staff director under President George W. Bush and soon to take over the defense policy program at the American Enterprise Institute. And thank you very much and welcome all to the NewsHour. I want to set up our first topic with a small setup piece about the decade that began with the Arab Spring and that ends with worldwide protest.
From the streets of Cairo,
President Hosni Mubarak has decided to step down.
And the demise of a dictator to Tunisia's Jasmine Revolution, protesters across the Middle East began the decade standing up to U.S.-backed authoritarian leaders they considered corrupt. In Syria, young people called for a peaceful transition of power, but the country descended into chaos and a civil and proxy war. The Arab Spring's legacy is decidedly mixed. The decade is ending the way it began. Across the world, protesters objecting to what they call corruption, inequality, authoritarianism. From Bolivia and Chile to Iran, Iraq, and Lebanon, popular protests are shaking established political systems, each fueled by local issues, but united in frustration and fueled by optimism that a better life is within reach in this decade of discontent.
Rebecca Heinrichs, when you think back to the Arab Spring, when you think about the protests today, do you see stability replaced with chaos?
I do see stability replaced with chaos. I think rather than the optimism that we had at the beginning of the Arab Spring, it's been replaced with, I think, realism and perhaps mixed with pessimism that democracy can win the day simply by supporting the small groups of people who would rightly wish to overthrow an authoritarian, even if that authoritarian was more stable. So now we had stable authoritarian, now replaced with chaos.
Corey Shockey, that idea that the stability that authoritarianism perhaps kept has been lost a little bit. When you see U.S. policy going forward, do you believe that it should be more based on principle than it has been?
Absolutely, it should be more based on principle. What people are protesting against in these societies is terrible governance. They want the rule of law, they want predictability, they want representative governance. And the United States should always be on the side of people demanding human dignity and individual rights.
Michelle Flournoy, is that realistic, that the U.S. can always be on that side?
Well, I do think we have to stand for democracy and freedom, better rights for people. I mean, that is who we are. That's our history. Those are our values. But the challenge is how to do that effectively. I think the best programs are the ones that work long-term, to invest in the foundations of civil society and sort of grow better governance over time.
Rebecca Heinrichs, is that realistic? Long-term investment? Is the political appetite in the U.S. for long-term investment in these countries?
I think long-term is the only way it will work. I do not think that we have the political appetite right now in the United States, especially after we see what's happening in Afghanistan, that our efforts there to create a democracy have not been met with fruit there that we wish after 18 years. And so I think that this desire, which I think is good for the United States, that we want to see other countries share the freedoms that we have, that it almost cheapens democracy to think that we can simply by helping or assisting in toppling these authoritarian governments that democracy will simply rise and remain stable. That simply has not been proven out in reality.
Corey Shockey, is that how you see it? And think about, for example, Saudi Arabia, an example where U.S. policy has been controversial, especially because of human rights violations.
So I see it slightly different than Rebecca and Michelle in that I think the United States very often takes too much responsibility for other people's outcomes. And it's certainly true that programs that help build society and independent media and autonomous judiciaries, those are all good long-term programs, but it's not good enough to tell people in the next generation, you will have a government that supports individual rights. And it seems to me that the craftsmanship of governance is understanding when problems are ripe, that the amount of effort the United States is willing to put to create change matches the moment. It's our responsibility to judge when and how we can help people create positive change for themselves.
One of the places around the world that people are creating their own opportunities certainly is Hong Kong, and then we've seen major protests there. And so let's take a little look at a setup story about the state of China and U.S. affairs.
In Beijing's Great Hall of the people celebrate one man. After the removal of term limits, Xi Jinping can be president for life. Under Xi, China has dramatically modernized its military and created outposts in the South China Sea, ignoring international law and U.S. objections. China has also expanded its influence abroad with the most expensive infrastructure project in history and advanced technology.
My administration has taken the toughest ever action to confront China's trade abuses.
But the Trump administration has confronted China, both on trade and international influence, and has called China a revisionist power whose goal is to displace U.S. preeminence.
Michelle Flournoy, are the U.S. and China destined for conflict?
I certainly hope not, because we're both nuclear powers. But we are certainly destined for a period of much greater competition, economically, technologically, for political influence around the world, and also potentially in the military sphere. The best thing we can do is actually invest in the drivers of our competitiveness here at home, whether it's science and technology, research and development, higher education, 21st century infrastructure. Why in the world do we not have a U.S. 5G industry, for example? So we are in for a longer competition. It would be a terrible failure of policy if that necessarily ends in conflict.
Corey Shockey, part of confronting China is the United States working with allies. Do you believe President Trump is working with allies to confront China?
No, I don't. In fact, I think he's squandering what is America's greatest strategic advantage in a competition with China, which is that we're historically pretty good at playing team sports. And China, because of its repression at home, its intimidation abroad, its refusal to play by the existing rules of the international order that have served the United States, other countries, including China, extraordinarily well, China's having a hard time getting anybody to support their view beyond Russia. And President Trump, because he seems unable to prioritize which arguments he wants to have, he's arguing with everybody all at once instead of making a common front with other countries who are nervous about China's behavior and who want American cooperation.
Rebecca Heinrichs, has President Trump squandered an opportunity, as we just heard?
I actually see it quite differently. I think this is where President Trump has the greatest strength in his administration, is that I really believe that if it wasn't for this particular administration, the United States would not be talking about great power competition with China in the way that we are, in the robust way that we are. You see themes all the way from the senior administration officials talking about how China is not good at reciprocity. It's opaque. You can't count on them. You've got businesses now taking a second guess and taking a second look at maybe they don't want to invest so thoroughly in China. So I'm optimistic about what the United States is doing now to set us on a good track for the years to come.
The U.S.'s oldest allies are in Europe, and there are tensions between the United States and Europe and within Europe. So let's take a look at a quick setup piece about the state of Europe, NATO, and the U.S.
Beyond the traditional stage photos at the NATO leaders' meeting, the transatlantic alliance is facing a crisis of identity and confidence. President Trump questions the alliance's foundation, emphasizing shared spending, not shared values. French President Emmanuel Macron says Trump has turned his back on NATO, and he recently called NATO brain dead in an attempt to shake up its strategic assumptions. And Europe is facing its own shakeup. British Prime Minister Boris Johnson just won a big political mandate based on his pledge to, in his words, get Brexit done.
Rebecca Heinrichs, should the U.S. have a tough conversation with Western Europe right now?
I think that's exactly what we're in the middle of. I think, all of the things that make so many people, I think, rightfully uncomfortable about President Trump, about his abrasive approach and the way he talks to people, many of these things that President Trump has brought up and raised are true, in fact. And as a result, we do see NATO spending more on defense, committing more on collective security. And then some of these other problems that he's raised, although they're not fixed, it's good that we're now addressing these head on.
Corey Shockey, NATO in a better place after President Trump's term or terms are done?
No, I don't think so. NATO has underlying problems that the president has has splashed a whole lot of attention to. But I think the question for the administration is whether the president's engagement with Europeans is going to solve those problems. And it doesn't look to me like it is. It doesn't look to me like it's producing greater European commitment. It does look to me like it is scaring Europeans and encouraging our adversaries to question the Article 5 guarantee that NATO allies make to each other, which is that an attack on one is an attack on all. So the increased defense spending, including by the United States, doesn't compensate for the anxiety and the questioning of our fundamental commitment. And that really is the result of the president's policies.
Michelle Flournoy, last word. This story isn't only about the tensions within the transatlantic alliance, but also when it comes to Turkey, who's in NATO, obviously, but also President Putin, who's about to celebrate his 20th year in power.
Yes, but the two are related. So I think the fact that we have our European allies questioning the U.S. commitment to NATO more fundamentally than they have since NATO's founding, that has created an opening. And it's to the delight of Vladimir Putin to be able to weaken NATO, to see dissension in NATO, and to start picking off allies like Turkey to say, hey, if you know, you can't rely on the United States, you're not sure of the predictability of their policy, the reliability of their leadership, let me sell you some air defenses for you. Sounds like a great deal, but that's a wonderful way to get in there and start dividing the alliance.
Michelle Flournoy, Rebecca Heinrichs, Corey Shockey, thanks to you all.
And what a decade it has been. Online, you can watch our in-depth series on protest movements that broke out across the globe this year with a deeper look tonight at the unrest in Hong Kong. You can find that when you follow us on Instagram at NewsHour. Stay with us coming up on the NewsHour, Breaking Through. Lily Singh on becoming the first woman of color to host a network late night show. On the NewsHour bookshelf, The Other Americans, immigrant stories immortalized in fiction. And United We Sing, a version of the holiday classic, Carol of the Bells. Today marked the first time since the French Revolution that Notre-Dame's famed cathedral did not host a Christmas service. Instead, its congregation, clergy, and choir celebrated midnight mass at a church across from the Louvre Museum. Notre-Dame's Monsignor warned there's a 50% chance that the 12th century cathedral, damaged in a fire this year, cannot be fully saved. That, as French officials plan restoration and repair work for 2021. As Jeffrey Brown reported this fall, major questions are being debated among the French about how best to save the cathedral. Here's a reprise of that report.
They are the fallen angels, once soaring high in the cathedral, now lying chipped, broken, and contaminated in the Historical Monument Research Laboratory in a suburb of Paris, where director Aline Magnet sums up the daunting challenge of restoring Notre Dame.
It's really a building site like no other. It's quite an extraordinary project, which is very difficult, very tough, and very demanding at the same time.
From some angles today, you can squint and imagine all is well at Notre Dame, but it is certainly not, and tourists and locals alike still mourn.
Just devastated for the world because of what a treasure it is.
It's the Eiffel Tower and Notre Dame when you think of Paris.
A monument burning is like the part of a piece of a history of humanity who vanished.
People continue to flock here as an act of witness or just out of curiosity, but now they're kept behind barriers and the entire site has been shut off to visitors. Inside, the cleanup work continues, and all around, the realization has grown of just how hard it will be to repair and restore the great cathedral.
The dust is mainly concentrated in seals like this, or on the banks of the Seine, between cobbles, or in inlays, or in cracks like this.
An immediate and ongoing problem, lead contamination. The fire melted hundreds of tons of lead in the roof, and the smoke carried and spread it throughout the surrounding area. Jacques Bonhumain of the French environmental group Robinhood says the government was slow to respond to a public health threat, even allowing visitors into the cathedral's plaza for the first months.
From around April 20th until August 20th, it was open. There were thousands of people, tourists, coming as families with children, who were lying on the ground to take photos and to eat.
Nearby schools like this one had to be decontaminated. The long-term health impact remains unclear. Also unclear, just how much of the lead found here in a city as old as Paris is due to the fire. Government officials insist they are taking it seriously, but Bonumaz Group has filed a lawsuit demanding more accountability.
What we really want, and this might surprise you, is that other cities in France, as a lot of towns in Spain and Italy, maybe even in the United States, that have beautiful monuments like Notre Dame, learn something from this fire and the way it was handled.
Lead contamination inside the cathedral has slowed the cleanup and forced workers to wear hazmat suits. In July, authorities offered several media organizations a tour of the interior, but not long after issued a dramatic new warning that the entire structure is still in danger of collapse. And stabilizing the walls is a priority before turning to any restoration of the spire and roof. At the lab outside Paris, Aline Magnin explained it this way.
There's a risk that Notre Dame's vault will become unstable, which would result in more stones falling and would put the public in danger. So we have to establish to what extent the stones are damaged and whether they still have some resistance, and then which stones we can keep and which ones need to be replaced.
Here, scientists study how stones drenched with water in the aftermath of the fire expand or contract as they dry.
This vault element has been used to make many, many little tests.
They're also conducting tests using lasers to clean the stones.
So the test is to see if the lead can be removed by this kind of method.
Yeah, on a small scale, and then we will go to the cathedral with the machine and make tests on the walls and the sculptures of the cathedral.
All of this will eventually lead to the main event, actually rebuilding and restoring Notre Dame. And surrounding that are many more issues. Though the cathedral dates to medieval times, the spire was actually a 19th century design by architect Eugène Viollet-le-Duc. Among the questions now, whether to restore the wooden and lead roof or use more modern materials, and whether to build an exact replica of the spire. When authorities put out a public call for new designs just days after the fire, Instagram lit up, including with some wild ideas. But the prevailing attitude seems to be rebuild it exactly as it was. Art historian Philippe Planeux.
I think our duty is to preserve the heritage we've inherited for future generations. And if we can't preserve it, then we should recreate it, reconstructing the cathedral, the roof, the spire, as it was before.
Another question, how soon can this be done? Immediately after the fire, French President Macron promised to rebuild within 5 years, a target many saw as timed to France's hosting of the 2024 Olympic Games. This summer, France's parliament created a new commission to oversee reconstruction, led by a former army chief. It's yet to formally meet, but we talked with one member, Monsignor Benoît de Sinati, who will represent the Catholic Church.
The most important thing to remember is that Notre Dame is first and foremost a cathedral, a church, a place of worship.
That may sound obvious, but debate had already swirled around Notre Dame for years as it became an often overrun tourist site. The Monsignor wants to use this moment to return to church values.
It's important to underline that when a bishop decided to build a cathedral in the Middle Ages, it was also a project to help the poorest in society. Today, when we're building Notre Dame, we're going to launch projects to help the most vulnerable in our society.
There are so many interests. There's political and economic and cultural, of course, and the church. There could be a clash.
Never in France.
Never in France? You mean always in France?
No.
Of course, there will be difficulties. There will be questions, big debates. In France, we like having big debates, asking questions. We can go on and on.
We love to speak.
But will the rebuilding go on and on? Like others we spoke with, Monsignor de Sinati wonders when the last stone will finally be put in place, the cathedral completely restored and reopened. But he does hope to celebrate Mass in Notre Dame within the next 5 years. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown in Paris.
A new face appeared in late-night television this fall, and she has broken all sorts of ground to get there. A Little Late with Lily Singh on NBC made 31-year-old Lily Singh the only woman and the only person of color to get that slot on a major network. We visited Lily on her Los Angeles set just before her debut. This Encore report is part of our series, Race Matters.
The 10 stages of diet grief.
She's one of YouTube's biggest success stories ever.
What up, everyone? It's a girl, Superwoman.
Lily Singh, aka Superwoman, first dipped a toe into internet waters 10 years ago with basic video blogs.
When it comes to our boyfriends, we want all the attention we can get, which makes us, okay, a little bit needy.
But she quickly dove in deeper. Developing her comedic skill.
No, girl, I'm wearing flats. Ain't nobody got time for heels tonight. Wait, what? Cargo splash,
give you a flash. And over the years, upping her production game. Translating both into 14 million subscribers and over 3 billion video views.
The president wanna build the wall cause I'm brown. I'm like Chris Jericho, I'll break the wall down.
She's now going where no YouTuber has gone before. Network television. Tonight, she'll make her debut on NBC as host of A Little Late with Lily Singh, taking over the late-night time slot from Carson Daly.
Welcome to the show.
Singh made the announcement in March, welcomed by her fellow NBC late-night hosts, Jimmy Fallon and Seth Meyers.
Indian-Canadian woman also.
Come on, man, yes. Breaking records.
So I'm super honored and humbled.
She built her fame by standing out online. And in her new role, Singh will definitely stand apart.
When your show premieres, you are going to be the only woman on the major networks in late night mm-hmm. in a sea of white male hosts. Mm-hmm. How are you thinking about that?
Honestly, it's exciting and nerve-wracking at the same time. I mean, it's a huge honor. I'm so humbled to be part of creating that path because let's be real, I wouldn't be here without the women that helped pave the path before me. But I think that's for the same reason it's so important for me to bring that authentic point of view, you know?
She'll also be the only woman of color on late night television and the first LGBTQ host of any network late night show ever. Singh came out as bisexual to her family last year and to her fans just 6 months ago.
It's been tough, but at the end of the day, I always say there's two ways that you can go. You can go the route that is scared, I'm scared, or you can go the route of I'm going to lead with love. And I think the route of leading with love is, even though this is scary, I'm going to share this about myself because it will help people. And all I want to do is encourage more people in our community, especially our South Asian community, to be like, even if something is scary and you're not supposed to talk about it, talk about it. Talk about it. Lead with love.
That lesson was years in the making, tracing back to 2010 when Singh posted her first video on YouTube. With no clear career plans, struggling with depression, and living in her parents' suburban Toronto home. But right away, Singh says, she knew this was her path.
And what was that conversation with your parents like? What is the line you deliver?
Okay, it was like, hey, I don't want to go to grad school. I would like to make videos on YouTube.
Sounds reasonable.
Yeah. They had a lot of questions, but I think in their mind, they were like, this is a phase. She's gonna grow out of it. Next year, she's gonna do these essays, get into graduate school. I do not think they were expecting me to make a career out of this. I don't think anyone was, to be fair. I got.
Branding herself as Superwoman, Singh set herself apart on a crowded internet by leaning into her view of the world.
Why the bloody hell did you wake up so late, huh?
Good morning to you too, Mom.
Posting campy impersonations of her parents.
It's bloody 2 p.m.
Girl, you should call me on your cell phone.
Writing and performing hip-hop parodies.
Late night when you need some treats.
And delivering a steady stream of observational humor in her signature over-the-top style.
Oh, sweet baby Jesus, is that double cheese?
As her followers and her fame grew, Singh's reach extended far beyond the internet. In just under 10 years, she ascended into entertainment's upper echelon, collaborating with Hollywood royalty like The Rock, pop culture stars like Selena Gomez, even interviewing then First Lady Michelle Obama.
No, you hang up.
The Lily Singh empire has now unfurled across media platforms. In 2017, she published a self-help book called How to Be a Boss, or as she would say it,
How to Be a Boss.
The book went on to become a New York Times bestseller. Her world tours sold out in dozens of countries. And her journey so far has even been documented in a 2016 film, A Trip to Unicorn Island.
I'm gonna take you all on a trip to Unicorn Island.
Unicorns, by the way, are sort of a thing for Singh.
I just like unicorns. Honestly, I am obsessed with them because I feel like anytime I talk about unicorns, people are so fixated on if they're real or not. And I feel like that misses the whole point.
What's
I feel like
point?
If I want to say I'm a unicorn, then I'm a unicorn. And you can just believe and be. And also, it's because my synonym for happy place is Unicorn Island.
For her next chapter, Singh has brought along the team from some of her biggest viral hits, hoping they can create the same success for NBC.
Social media people are mine. The editor is mine.
Got my desk out here.
Equally important, she says, is the history she's carrying forward. In 1986, Joan Rivers became the first woman given a shot at the late-night chair, but she failed to gain traction and was quickly taken off the air. It took decades before another woman was given a chance, and since then, no woman has made it past a single season in late night on any major network.
And so it's a lot to deal with, but I always just remind myself that it's part of chipping away that path. And so regardless of what the outcome is, if I'm being super candid with you, it's kind of not going to matter because it's going to help continue pave that path. And that's what my priority is, you know.
You're saying regardless of how this goes, mm-hmm. the fact that you are here.
I mean, we want it to go well. There's no doubt we want it to go well. What I'm saying is, like, my actual presence and everyone else being a part of this is already going to contribute to paving that path.
In some ways, Singh is uniquely qualified to succeed in the new world of late night, one in which hosts are scrambling to turn television segments into internet sensations.
When I'm sitting with my writers and we're going through the show format, I think, great, that's a great show. And I think by nature, my brain automatically goes, that's going to be the YouTube part of it, and this is what the title is going to be, and that's going to be great.
So it's kind you can just see that.
It's already built in. Like, I'm already sitting with my writers being like, perfect, and we'll call it this, and we'll frame the question like this, it'll be done. So I think it's just a different way of thinking. You know, it's about thinking about two formats rather than just one. Come on. We're out here making statements. Statements on statements out here. I love it.
When her show premieres tonight, Singh says she knows she'll be speaking to a largely new television audience, one she won't have much time to win over.
I want to go out there and be like, this is my point of view, this is what I'm going through, these are my thoughts and feelings, this is the person I am, and this is the person I want you to get to know, not just talk show host, but like, I want you to get to know Lily.
Now, a new entry on the NewsHour bookshelf. Jeffrey Brown caught up with the National Book Award fiction finalist Leila Lalami at the Miami Book Festival. Her latest work of fiction, The Other Americans, explores issues of immigration and identity, part of our ongoing arts and culture series, Canvas.
Leila Lalami, nice to talk to you.
Thank you for having me.
I don't usually start this way, but looking at the title itself, The Other Americans, what does that mean? What did you mean by that phrase?
Well, the book starts off with the death in a hit and run of a Moroccan immigrant, mm-hmm. and basically is told from the perspective of nine different characters who, while they are all tied to this man in one way or another, also have the shared experience of feeling as though they are on the outside, either because they are immigrants, whether they are documented or undocumented or naturalized, or have moved from one part of this country to another. So, for mm-hmm. example, the detective who's investigating the hit and run has moved from Washington, D.C. to this small desert town where the action takes place. Mm-hmm. And so all of the characters really share this experience of feeling as though they are other in some sense. And that's what tied the book together. I think that's why I picked the title.
But it begins as a kind of murder mystery at yeah. its heart. You have that style of writing, a kind of whodunit.
Yeah.
But grafted onto that are much bigger themes.
I started working on this book in 2014, and my dad had gotten really sick, and I had to travel to Morocco and I really thought that he was near death. And mm-hmm. fortunately, he recovered, and he's fine now. But that experience really brought home for me some of the longer-term consequences of immigrating to this country more than 25 years ago. And I thought I might start the book really exploring that and exploring the grief of loss, which was the thing that scared me. And in order to do that, I thought that framing it as a mystery might mm-hmm. keep me interested and keep me going in terms of writing the story and having sort of a propulsive energy to the narrative.
In what ways does fiction work or perhaps not work sometimes to explore big issues like this?
I think it works really well to explore these issues. I think one of the problems in writing about issues like this in nonfiction is that it's impossible to do it without taking sides. In fiction, when you write about themes such as exclusion or racism or discrimination, there is the possibility of showing different perspectives, and each perspective retains its own integrity in a way. So when the wife is recounting this event, it's a story of grief. When the detective is talking about it, it's a crime story.
Yeah.
When the daughter is talking about it, it's also a story of loss and missed opportunities. So it's just a different way of looking at story. And I really do believe that fiction allows the possibility to tell the truth in a way that nonfiction doesn't, because nonfiction is more interested in facts. Mm-hmm. And I think that there is a difference between facts and truth.
Mm-hmm. The main protagonist, the man who is killed, mm-hmm. and he gets to tell part of his story too, mm-hmm. he really talks openly about the American dream, and mm-hmm. his daughter talks about mm-hmm. him seeing mm-hmm. his living the American dream. So you are really exploring that. You're taking this head on.
He's an interesting character because he had not intended on immigrating to the United States. He was a graduate student in philosophy, of all things, mm-hmm. and got involved
in Morocco,
yeah. and got involved in different political events that caused him to want to leave. And he went from being somebody who's very much, I would say, I mean, he had like Marxist tendencies, to when he arrived in the U.S., mm-hmm. starting a business and embracing fully the idea of the American dream. And of course, the irony is that on the very first page of the book, when you open the book, he dies in this very mysterious hit and run, and we're not clear on what reasons there are behind it.
How much of this comes from your own background, your own experience as an immigrant yourself?
In my case, I became an immigrant because I met an American, and we fell in love, and we got married. And before I knew it, I was an immigrant and then later a citizen. And I've really spent a lot of time really reflecting on this experience and how it has changed my life. And I realized that this is something that ties me to more than 40 million people in this country, to a great number of people in this country. And each of them has a very different life experience, a different reason for why they're immigrating. And in the book, I tried to explore two or three of these experiences. Most of the book is the work of the imagination, but the nugget of what really got me started into it and the inspiration came from just the experience of being an immigrant.
And how much of it is tied to the politics of our time? Because I know you also write columns and essays, and you address these issues.
Yeah.
In that way, too.
Yeah. So to me, this is really a book that's more general about the experience of immigration in America. And I sort of leave my own political opinions about the here and the now to other work. So I have actually a book of nonfiction coming out next year in which I talk a bit more about the experience of immigration from a nonfiction perspective. Mm-hmm. So.
But in the novel, you chose to do something different.
Yeah. I mean, in the novel, it's more about the private experience of immigration, speak a foreign language, which is what I'm doing right now. Mm-hmm. And especially when you first arrive in the country and you mispronounce something and somebody laughs, or you don't quite know, you know, the culture or some of the jokes that people are laughing about. And so this experience of being on the outside is an experience that I've had in my life, not mm-hmm. just because I'm an immigrant, but also, for example, after I finished my PhD, I worked in tech, and oftentimes I was the only woman in the room. Mm. So it's just like this experience of being on the outside is one that I have spent a lot of time thinking about. And I think most of my fiction really is about the act of crossing borders and the implications that it has.
Did you feel that you had to wrap it up or tie it up in some way or resolve things or?
Well, the characters are very much unresolved, and the book is really about the relationships between them. It's not as if they start out in one point and they end up in another point where everything is perfectly sorted out in their lives. It's not quite like that. It's really about how they relate to one another in the aftermath of this crime. Yeah. We do find out who was behind all of it, but the book is really an opportunity to look at their relationships to one another.
All right, the book is The Other Americans, Leila Lalami. Nice to talk to you.
Nice talking to you, too.
And finally, on this Christmas night, we continue a tradition started a few years ago when we asked the U.S. military to share a holiday story or song. Tonight, musicians from the Air Force, Army, Navy, Marine Corps, and Coast Guard perform Carol of the Bells. This video was produced by the Defense Media Activity Group, an agency within the Department of Defense.
Christmas is here, bringing good cheer to young and old, meek and the bold. Ding dong, ding dong, that is their song, with joyful ring, all caroling. One seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air. Oh, how they pound, raising the sound, more hill and dale, telling the tale. Gaily they ring while people sing songs of good cheer. Christmas is here.
Merry, 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 merry Christmas.
Merry, 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 merry Christmas.
All of the bells, sweet silver bells, all seem to say, throw cares away. Christmas is here, bringing good cheer to young and old, meek and the bold. Ding dong, ding dong, that is the song, with joyful ring, all caroling.
One seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air. Oh, how they pound, raising the sound, all in the dance, and the tale. Gaily they ring while people sing songs of good cheer. Christmas is here.
Merry, 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 merry Christmas. Merry, 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 merry Christmas.
Dong on the bells, sweet silver bells, all seem to say, throw cares away. Christmas is here, bringing good cheer to young and old, meek and the bold. Ding dong, ding dong, that is the song, with joyful ring, all caroling. One seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air. Oh, how they pound, raising the sound, all hill and dale, telling the tale. Gaily they ring, while people sing songs of good cheer. Christmas is here, ding dong, merry, merry, merry Christmas. Ding dong, merry, merry Christmas.
Dong on the bells, sweet silver bells, all seem to say, throw cares away. Christmas is here, bringing good cheer to young and old, meek and the bold. Ding dong, ding dong, that is their song. Ding, joyful ring, all caroling.
One seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air. Oh, how they pound, praising the song, calling and air, telling the tale. Gaily they ring while people sing songs of good cheer. Christmas is here. Ding,
merry, merry, merry Christmas song.
Ding,
Bom. A little Christmas tradition at the NewsHour continues. On the NewsHour online right now, as the decade comes to a close, what's changed? From smartphones to the effects of climate change to the Me Too movement, we take a look at seven major shifts that have shaped our world. That's on our website, pbs.org/newshour. And that is the NewsHour for tonight. On tomorrow's NewsHour, National Book Award winner Sarah Broom on her memoir about life in New Orleans to get to visit, The Yellow House is the name of the book. I'm Amna Nawaz. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you for spending your Christmas Day with us. We'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Consumer Cellular, BNSF Railway, and with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.